गुड इवनिंग वन एंड ऑल, माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर रूपश्री. टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस अ टॉपिक दैट इज हाइड्रेटिफार्मोल. सम स्टूडेंट्स हैव आस्क्ड मी रिगार्डिंग द डाउट्स रिगार्डिंग द इथियोपैथोजेनेसिस. सो लेट मी कंप्लीट द टॉपिक. ओके, हाइड्रेटिफार्मोल. व्हाट इज हाइड्रेटिफार्मोल? ओके, सी इट इज एन एबनॉर्मल सी इट इज एन एबनॉर्मल कंडीशन ऑफ द प्लेजेंटा. ओके, बिकॉज ऑफ द डिजनरेटिव एंड प्रोलिफरेटिव चेंजेस ऑफ द कोरियोनिक विल्लाई. Okay, what is this chorionic villi? See, what is this chorionic villi? See, actually this is the placenta. It is a normal placenta. Okay, when we take the section of this placenta and examine under the microscope, it is the chorionic villi. This is the chorionic villi. Okay, what happens is there are some proliferative and degenerative changes in the chorionic villi. Okay, because of this, when we examine under the microscope, see, these are the degenerative and proliferative changes. Degenerative, proliferative changes is most important points you have to remember in the hydratiform mold. So it resembles in the formation of a small cluster of cyst. It is known as hydrated cyst. So this is a normal placenta with the maternal side with cotyledons. Because of the degenerative and proliferative changes of this chorionic villi, it results in the formation of small cyst known as hydratiform mole, and it results in the hydrated cyst with accumulation of fluid in the cyst. Okay, see the small grape-like vesicles. There will be accumulation of some vesicular fluid in this cyst. We have observed the normal placenta and the placenta with hydratiform mold. Okay, next. See, what are the questions they are going to ask is, see, what is the definition of the hydratiform mold? That is a abnormal condition of the placenta, degenerative proliferative changes is a question. And next is, we'll see, what is the pathogenesis? Okay, what happens is, in case of normal conception, see, this is the ovum with 23X and this is the sperm of 23X or 23Y. When these two fuse, what happens? It results in the formation of a zygote or a fertilized ovum. It is about 46XX. This is the normal pregnancy. Okay. Sometimes what happens is the ovum is inactive. The sperm fuses with this inactive ovum and it undergoes meiosis or division on its own. It results in the formation of 46XX. It divides continuously and results in 46XX cell duplication. In this, only the maternal chromosomes are involved or only the sperm is involved, haploid sperm. And so it is known as paternal chromosomal duplication or androgenesis. Androgenesis. This is known as complete mole. There only the involvement of sperm is present. So what happens is there is no formation of any zygote or no pregnancy. Okay, see, this is the complete hydratiform mole with vesicles, grape like structures or vesicles. Okay, this is a complete mole. You all understood na? That it is a haploid sperm meeting an inactive egg. Apart from these, other condition what we see in hydratiform mold is, here the ovum is active with 23X, but a haploid sperm should fuse. But here two sperms, that is diploid sperms, that is 23X and 23Y are fusing. It results in the formation of triploidy. So this 23, 23, 23. It results in 69XXY. Or XYY. Okay, see, it may result in 69XXY or sometimes 69XYY. Okay, here the two sperms are involved with an active egg. Here both the sperm as well as the egg is involved. So it results in the formation of a fetus. But because of some conditions like multidisciplinary or some multi-system organ involvement will take place, and so the survival of the fetus is very risky. Okay, so we maximum terminate the pregnancy by 16 to 18 weeks. See, this is the partial mold. See, this is the placenta with the vesicles as well as the fetus. Okay, What are the questions they are going to ask in this slide are, see, what is the complete mole and how it will form? Okay, why it is called as androgenesis? Okay, and what is the haploidy of this complete mole? And the next is, what is partial mole and in which condition the fetus is present? Okay, if we see the fetus in the partial mole, these two questions they are going to ask. Okay, now we came to see that complete mole and partial mole. So we have examined this inactive nucleus, and here is the active nucleus. There is embryo or fetus is absent in the complete mole, and in the partial mole, because of the involvement of the sperm and the ovum, the embryo or fetus may be present, but it will not continue till the end of the pregnancy. See, what happens is, when we observe this complete mole under histopathological examination, we see diffuse hydropic degeneration, that is degeneration of the villi. Okay, villi means chorionic villi degeneration, stroma degeneration, blood vessel degeneration, only excess proliferation of trophoblast is there. Means there is degeneration of the hydropic, means water. This is a degeneration of the stroma, blood vessels, everything is diffuse degeneration is present. But in case of focal hydropic degeneration, that is in case of partial mole, see, the chorionic villi are present. See the villi. The chorionic villi are present. Along with that, the trophoblasts are getting proliferated. Stroma is present. See, the stroma is present, and well as the blood vessels are present. Blood vessels, stroma, see the villi proliferation, and see the trophoblast. Just please compare the complete mole histopathological slide with the partial mole histopathological slide. Then you will find the complete difference between them. Never by heart. Please understand the concept and you will get it clearly. Next, we will see the differences. See, in case of complete mole, what happens is, because of the accumulation of the blood products, other degenerative material, the uterine size is more than period of amenorrhea. Almost in about 60 to 70% of the conditions, in case of hydatidiform mole, uterine size will be more than the period of amenorrhea. Okay, and in case of a partial mole, the period of amenorrhea will be less. I will take an example. This is the normal uterus of 16 weeks. Okay, in case of complete mole, the condition will be as if it is 22 to 24 weeks. Okay, but in case of partial mole, it will resemble that it may be 14 to 16 weeks. Because of all the accumulation of blood clots, everything, it becomes more. Okay, in this slide, they will ask a question regarding that what are the true statements, or all are true except one, like that they will be asking. So in some conditions, they may ask you that uterine size will be more than period of amenorrhea in case of complete mole. Is it true or false? Because accumulation of the blood clots, all the degenerated materials. Okay, now see. What happens is, because of some hormonal changes in case of hydatidiform mole, what happens is, in the ovary, in the hydatidiform mole, there is involvement of the uterus as well as the ovary. So, what happens is, the follicles will become more and more, the bigger size. That is, there may be bilateral theca lutein cyst. See, this is the uterus. Okay, see, these are the ovaries. See the follicles. See, this is an ultrasound image. See the follicular size. Okay. And in case of partial mole, there also the theca lutein cysts are present. But they are not so common. See, compare this image with this one. Here, less number of cysts are present. Okay. So, the question that can be asked is, bilateral theca lutein cyst is seen in complete mole. You say hydatidiform mole. What happens is, after complete suction evacuation or curating the these products, what happens is, the HCG levels decreases. These follicles are because of increased beta HCG levels. Immediately after suction evacuation, what happens is, the beta HCG levels will decrease. And so, what happens is, it decreases, the follicular size also decreases. Now, complete mole. In case of risk of persistence of the disease, in complete mole, the persistence of the disease is 20%. Okay, and the maximum beta HCG level rise will be almost more than 50,000 to 1 lakh. And this is the beta HCG structure what I have put is, okay, it may be 50,000 to 1 lakh. In case of persistence of disease, that is, in case of partial mole, it is less than 5%. It is less than 5%. So only slight elevation, it is less than 50,000. Okay. What are the causes? Okay, what are the causes of this hydatidiform mole? Always in obstetrics, first point you have to remember is age. For any condition, if you don't know anything regarding the topic also, what may be the causative factor? It is the age. Okay, age. It may be teenage pregnancies, or it may be elderly pregnancy of greater than 35 years. Okay, and nutritive factors like there may be inadequate intake of proteins or excess animal fat or low dietary intake of carotene. Okay, when the carotene level is very less also, it results in the formation of hydatidiform mole. And next is some disturbed maternal immune mechanisms will be there. That is, even though the liver enzymes are normal, there is rise in the gamma globulin level. Okay, because gamma globulin is one of the enzyme of the liver. When we do all the liver function test, the liver enzymes, liver histology will be normal, but the enzyme will be raised. This is because of the maternal immune, disturbed maternal immune mechanisms. And see, the molar pregnancy is most commonly seen in the oriental countries. Oriental countries means nearby countries like, see, beside India. India is also one of the condition, like China, Japan, okay, Philippines, and it is mostly highest is seen in Philippines, that is, it is 1:80. In Philippines, it is about 1:80, and in India, it is about 1:400. Okay, in this slide, the most important points which can be asked are, one is molar pregnancy, it is highest in case of Philippines, first point, and other conditions like age factors may be asked, or sometimes disturbed maternal immune mechanisms like gamma globulin levels are raised. This may be a question. Okay. Next. Now you all came to know what is hydatidiform mole. It is an abnormal condition of the placenta. First point. Next. What is the main pathogenesis? That it is an abnormality between the fusion of the sperm and the ovum. That is complete mole, partial mole we have discussed. Now other conditions, other associated conditions we have discussed. Now clinical features. What are the important clinical features is bleeding. See. Patient complains of bleeding. Patient comes to hospital with bleeding. In that bleeding, we can observe what? That is gelatinous fluids. That is some vesicles. As I see this, shiny material, shiny vesicles. This is shiny because of the accumulation of the vesicular fluid. See, this is all complete blood. Okay? Blood with blood clots. Right? Blood with blood clots. But see, the shiny material is present here. Right? See, gelatinous fluid. Because of the rupture of the vesicles, okay, the blood is red in color with some fluid. Okay, it is described as white current and red current juice. Okay, see, already red juice. Red juice means here blood. In the red color, some gelatinous fluid is present, that is white. So, white current in red current juice. And next is patient complaints of lower abdominal pain. Why the abdominal pain will be there? Because, see, what happens is because of accumulation of the blood clots, all the degenerated products, the uterus goes on stretching, 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 stretching. What happens? After stretching to the maximum point, one day what happens? There may be slight perforation of the uterus. So, because of the perforation, patient complains of severe abdominal pain. Next, because of the rise of the beta HCG level, what happens is there is increased nausea and vomiting. Patient complains of excess nausea, vomiting because of the raised beta HCG levels. And patient complains of some of the thyroid features like tremors and tachycardia. Why? Because HCG has two components, alpha, beta. Okay? Alpha, beta. One is alpha, one is beta. Now, what happens? The alpha component is similar to FSH, LH. Okay? It is similar to FSH, LH and TSH. So, what happens is, because of the rise in the alpha component, TSH is raised. TSH is raised means hypothyroid features. Sometimes tremors, tachycardia may be possible. Okay. Next, breathlessness. Why? Because of the rupture of this uterus, all the products, all the vesicles now enter into the lung. It enters into the lung. So the patient complains of breathlessness because of the pulmonary embolization due to vesicles. And last is expulsion of grape-like vesicles per vaginum. See, this is the metastasis. All the blood and blood products are now embolization, means they are moving towards the lung and they get deposited in the lung, and now the patient complains of breathlessness. Now the last one is expulsion of grape-like vesicles. See, this is the vesicles. This is the vesicle. Okay, expulsion of grape-like vesicles per vaginum. These are the clinical features. Now, what are these questions asked is, in last 10 years papers, you check all, you will find the most important one point of the hydrative formula, that is white current in the red current juice. What is this? Means hydrative formula. Okay. Next. As I have already said, now we have taken the history. Patient has said all the symptoms. Now we have to observe for the signs. Means observation of the signs means you should do per abdomen and next per vaginum. So in per abdomen, see, uterus size, as I have said, in case of complete mole, almost 70% of the uterus will be more than the period of amenorrhea. Okay. In some 10%, 20% of the cases, it is equal to period of amenorrhea, and otherwise, other size, that is, it responds to the 10% of the cases, it is less than period of amenorrhea. Okay. And now see, the feel of the uterus is firm. Why firm? Why? Because there is no fetus, no amniotic fluid. No fluid means it is duff, like chapati atta, duff, it will be duff and it will be firm. Okay, there are no fetal parts, no fetal heart sounds, nothing is there because there is no fetus at all. Okay, and now you will do per vaginum. In case of per vaginum, I have shown you the slide now. See, all the expulsion of grape-like vesicles. These are the grape-like vesicles in the vaginal discharge. Grape-like vesicles. Okay, I have already shown the slide to you. And the next one is, there is enlargement of the ovaries because of the what? Because of the beta HCG hormone. See, these are the Tika lutein cyst. There is unilateral or bilateral enlargement of the ovaries also. Okay. See, the fetus. This is the fetus. I am showing you the partial mole. These are the vesicles. Vesicles and fetus. See, as I said, it is already Tika lutein cyst. Now, what are the investigations you will be doing? Is every time in OBG investigation means first point is CBP. You see what is the hemoglobin, what is the platelets and what is the blood group. Okay. See. Now next is the thyroid levels. I have already said that patient will be complaining of tremors and palpitations and liver function test to see whether the gamma globulin level is raised or not. And next is the renal function test for anesthesia, for dilatation and curettage or suction evacuation. Now the last unique examination is the ultrasound. In ultrasound, what you'll see, there is no strong appearance. See, dispersion of the vesicles, this is the uterus. See, this is the uterus. See, all the vesicles, fluid filled vesicles, which are dispersed into the cavity of the uterus. Okay, so usually this is a no strong appearance. Now, what we'll measure, the lab test, one lab test should be done. That is the raised beta HCG level. If patient complains of any breathlessness, tachycardia, palpitations, go for chest X-ray to see whether there is lung involvement or not. So chest X-ray is one of the important thing. Now the histological confirmation. Histological confirmation means we do this after doing suction evacuation. Okay, this is for suction evacuation. Histological confirmation can be done. Okay, After chest X-ray, if required, histological confirmation can be done. What are the important questions in this means? One gunshot or stock question of hydatiform mole. If no strong appearance, see the dispersion of all the vesicles within the cavity of the uterus. So if they give any small clue that when ultrasound we can see the snowstorm appearance means it is hydatiform mole, or what is the gunshot point of ultrasound in case of hydatiform mole is snowstorm appearance. See a person in the snow. Now treatment. Okay. Treatment. First, in gynec or obstetrics, anywhere, first is the important point is a supportive therapy. Supportive therapy means IV fluid. Okay, arranging of all the blood and blood products. If required, blood transfusion, because hydatiform mole patients will be bleeding a much. Now, we just dilate the cervix and curate all the products. This is the dilatation and curettage. Just remove all the products and send for histological examination. Next is the See, this is dilation, the Haggard's dilator. This is a Haggard's dilator, which is dilate the cervix, dilate it, and then curate all the products. See, all the abnormal tissue should be removed like this. Okay. Now the suction evacuation. See, this is a suction. See. This is all the abnormal tissue of the hydatiform mole. Okay. Now just this is the abnormal tissue. Just put a simple suction, connect it to it, and just remove all the products of the uterus. It is a suction evacuation. Okay. Now hysterotomy. Sometimes what happened is the patient may be third gravida, fourth gravida with the previous LSCSs. What happens is sometimes they will be very difficult for doing all this dilatation or some suction evacuation, or it becomes a problem. So what happens is we just open the anterior part of the uterus. We just open it. We just make a hole to the anterior wall of the uterus and we remove the products. Okay. And then we normally suture it again. This is known as hysterotomy. Hyster means uterus. Hyster means uterus. Otomy means making a hole. Okay, this is hysterotomy. Making a hole to the anterior wall of the uterus is a hysterotomy. It is done when there is no progress, or if we doubt that there will be very difficult for the doing any dilatation or any suction evacuation, then we go to the hysterotomy. Next is hysterectomy. That is sometimes what happens is because in hydatiform mole, the uterus will be very soft. Sometimes if we introduce any dilator or catheter, excess curating makes it, and sometimes there become a small perforation to the uterine wall. In that conditions, if a patient is not ready for any reproductive function, she don't want her menstrual function or any reproductive functions, then we can go for if in last stages, there is no chance for the survival, then what we can do? We can advise hysterectomy to the patient. If there is any perforation of the uterus, or we are unable to operate the perforated uterus, or there may be infected uterus in some conditions, that time we go directly for the hysterectomy. Then counsel the patient for the regular follow-up with beta HCG levels. Beta HCG levels for regular follow-up. And last is a contraception, that is advise patient for the barrier contraception for until the beta HCG becomes normal. Becomes normal. And other thing is, after 6 months of beta HCG becomes normal, advise OC pills. Until all the follicles which are present in the ovary have completed a cycle and new follicles will be raising, at that time when the beta hCG levels are normal, advise her OC pills. Never advise intrauterine contraceptive device because of the fear of pelvic infections. Okay, now what are the questions they are going to ask is, what is the primary treatment in case of hydatidiform mollies? First, we do suction evacuation or direct station curettage. If not possible, hysterectomy, then hysterectomy. Now, contraception is very important. Is first we advise barrier contraception until the beta hCG levels become normal. After they are stable and after they become normal, advise her regarding the OC pills. Now, how you will make a follow-up with the patient? Follow-up is very important in case of hydatidiform mole, because these beta hCG levels are checked 48 hours after suction evacuation. Now, on Monday, you have done the suction evacuation. Okay, Tuesday, Wednesday. On Thursday, patient should report with beta hCG levels to the OPD to see whether the beta hCG levels are decreased or not. Okay, beta hCG levels checked 48 after suction evacuation. Now, after they have decreased, now weekly monitoring should be done. So, this Monday, she has done suction evacuation. On Thursday, she has brought a report of beta hCG levels. Now, again ask her for Monday. Every Monday like that, until the beta hCG levels have completely become normal. Okay, so every Monday, she should bring a report. Okay. Now, if the beta hCG levels are greater than 10% increased or greater than 10% over a period of 2 weeks, or there is persistence of elevated beta hCG levels, simply you remember, if there is any elevation of the beta hCG levels, or if there is any persistence of beta hCG levels more than 6 months, or in the HPE, if it is diagnosed as choriocarcinoma, all these factors will lead to the development of gestational trophoblastic neoplasm. Okay, it will result in gestational trophoblastic neoplasm. Okay, if they are raised or if they are persistent or if there is any diagnosis of choriocarcinoma, then we will suspect for trophoblastic neoplasm. And if there is any evidence of metastasis, okay, any evidence of metastasis, prophylactic chemotherapy with methotrexate of 1 mg per kg body weight on 1357 and folic acid of 0.1 mg per kg body weight on 2468. Why we are giving methotrexate with folic acid? Because methotrexate is a folic acid inhibitor. It decreases the levels of the folic acid. So, to decrease the toxicity of the methotrexate, okay, methotrexate, what we are doing, we are giving folinic acid along with it. Okay, if the cycles have become normal, give 2 to 3 such cycles so that there will not be any residual amount which are present in the body. Okay, now the treatment is methotrexate along with the folic acid, that is 1357-2468. And the questions which can be asked are, again, when should you get follow-up with beta hCG levels to the OPD? One question may be there, that is after 48 hours. And other thing is, what are the conditions? What are the true statements in which there is a suspicious of choriocarcinoma in case of hydatidiform mole? Is when there is elevation of beta hCG, when there is a persistence of beta hCG for more than 6 months, and histopathological examination reveals choriocarcinoma. These may be the true statements in case of hydatidiform mole. And last is, what is the treatment? What is the prophylactic chemotherapy that is given in hydatidiform mole? It is methotrexate. To decrease the toxicity of the methotrexate, what are you going to do? That is folinic acid. Okay. The days also they will be asking 1357 and 2468. These are the days what you will give. They will be asking. Okay. Now, complications. In complications, patient will come with bleeding. So, patient comes with bleeding, and it may result in hypovolemic shock. Because of bleeding, there may be hypovolemic shock. Next is sepsis. Because of the accumulation of blood clots, all degenerated products, what happens is the os gets open in case of hydatidiform mole while expulsion of the products. The organisms which are present in the vagina or cervix, what happens, they enter, they go ascending upwards and they cause the sepsis of the uterine cavity. Okay, so it results in the sepsis. Next, perforation of the uterus because of the excess accumulation of the blood clots. And what happens is, because of the rupture of these, the vesicles which are present inside the uterus now enter into the lung. Okay, now enter into the lung. And it leads to the acute pulmonary insufficiency. And because of the deposition of the fibrin in the vascular system, it leads to the coagulation failure. So, complete coagulation failure will be there. And last is, there in complete mold, there is 20% chance of hydatidiform form mold to develop into choriocarcinoma. So she should be on regular follow-up, and patient, if required, she may be advised for hysterectomy. Okay, so complications are hemorrhage, shock, sepsis, there may be perforation of the uterus, or there may be pulmonary insufficiency because of the deposition of the fibrin, coagulation failure. Last is a choriocarcinoma. So important questions are, what are the complications which are seen in hydatidiform mold? Mostly they will be asking, will coagulation failure will be there in hydatidiform mold? Yes, it will be there. Reason is, it is because of the excess accumulation of fibrin within the vascular system. Will there be any pulmonary insufficiency in the hydatidiform mold? Yes, because of the deposition or pulmonary embolization of the vesicles to the lung. How much percent of the hydatidiform mold, complete mold, develops into choriocarcinoma? 20%. All these are questions which can be asked more frequently. Okay, sometimes they will give all the complications and they will be saying, what are the complications related to which disease? That is hydatidiform mold. Okay, because some students have asked me regarding this, I have prepared this. I think you all have understood this. And let us meet in the next class. And I thank you very much.